Thank you, Jeff Harkins and your team for putting that together for us this morning. I'll now call the Paulding County Board of Commissioners work session to order on this May 25th, 2021. I don't see any elected officials with us this morning. Tommy, if you bring the list forward and while he's walking up, if your phone's on, silence it, please. Thank you, sir. And I'm so excited and pleased to see Blake Trent, Pastor Blake Trent from Dallas First United Methodist Church, who's with us this morning, to bring us her invocation and to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. Stand if you're able.
Well, I brought my own patriotic thing to read this morning, so I'll read this and then offer our invocation. This is a letter from the Executive Mansion in Washington, D.C. on November 21st, 1864. Dear Madam, I have been shown in the files of the War Department a statement of the Adjutant General of Massachusetts that you are the mother of five sons who have died gloriously on the field of battle. And I feel I have now been shown, and I feel weak and fruitless, how many of my words must seem to beguile you from the grief of loss that is so overwhelming. But I cannot refrain from tendering you the consolation that may be found in the thanks of this republic for which they died to save. I pray that our Heavenly Father may assuage the anguish of your bereavement and leave you only the cherished memories of the loved and the lost and the solemn pride that must be yours to have laid so costly a sacrifice upon the altar of freedom. Yours sincerely and respectfully, President Abraham Lincoln. Let us pray. Grant unto us, O God, a vision for this community and for your world, a vision as your love would shape it, a world where the weak are protected and none go hungry or poor. A community where the riches of your creation are shared and available so that all may experience their goodness. A world where different races and cultures live in harmony and mutual respect of each other. A community where peace is built with justice and justice is guided by love and grace. And now, O glorious Lord, give to us these leaders the inspiration and the courage to build a community here in Paulding County, to use our influence and talents to grow, equip, and care for those who are here and those who are to come, so that it may become the beloved community where you are present and where all know your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you'll join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thanks so much, Pastor Trent, for starting our meeting off the way it should be started. Under minutes, the May 11th, 2021 work session minutes and the May 11th, 2021 board meeting minutes are available for review. Under our announcements, the Team Paulding segment this morning, we're going to look at Code Red weather warning system first.
I'm Stephen Dooley, Deputy Director of Paulding County Emergency Management, and I'm here today to talk to you about our mass notification system.
Code Red is the mass notification system for Paulding County. Code Red automatically delivers advanced notification of severe weather events as soon as a warning is issued by the National Weather Service. The warnings are to provide residents with the time necessary to prepare for severe weather emergencies.
The goal of these notifications are to prompt citizens to take recommended actions to protect life and property.
From a cell phone, text MyPauldingGA to 99411 to receive a direct link to the enrollment form on the mobile device. You may also visit paulding.gov and click on Emergency Management, and then click on the code red icon and follow registration instructions. Additionally, you may visit at Paulding County EMA on either Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram social media platforms. For assistance with registration, you may call 770-222-1160, extension 5.
Thank Mr. Dooley and also Chief Pelfrey for keeping our county safe through this new system. The Board of Commissioners would like to present the Public Safety Award to Firefighter Noah Braden, and Chief Pelfrey is going to make some remarks, and it's great to have in the room a very quality group of firefighters, so welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
He's a little surprised this morning. They didn't tell him, I found out. He's like, why am I here? Thank y'all for letting us recognize our employees for Public Safety Award. It means a lot to them. As you can tell, they got all the support in the world back here. So I had a couple of supervisors nominated him for this award, so I'm going to read some of the words that they gave me. For professional achievement and superior performance of his duties with Paulding County Fire Rescue Company 1, Firefighter Noah Braden is nominated for consideration of the Board of Commissioners Public Safety Appreciation Award. Firefighter Braden is the primary firefighter assigned to Rescue 1, which has been the busiest apparatus in the county during the COVID outbreak. He upholds the highest morals, even during the most intense emergency calls. Since being hired and entering our recruit school in January 2018, his commitment to his training and career development is outstanding. Firefighter Braden has been working hard to complete all the prerequisites classes necessary to advance to the next level in our department. In his short time with the department, he's been completing most of his classes on his own time. He attended our first EMT program and earned his Advanced Emergency Medical Technician certification. He earned his National Professional Qualification certification as a fire apparatus operator, which is advanced skill training in fire pumper operations. He's also completed several fire officer series classes to understand the roles and responsibilities of a company officer. Noah is a key part of the B-Shift crew and participates in all training exercises, including the newly created MOD classes designed to provide firefighters with basic skill set of advanced tools and training within the department. Young firefighters like Noah are the future leaders of our department, and he's doing it the right way by having a positive demeanor and exemplary character that reflects great credit upon himself and in keeping with the highest traditions of the fire service. We're proud of you. He's only been here a little over 3 years, and he has just been, grass is not growing under his feet, and he's very well respected in the short time he's been here, as you can tell, and they support him, and he supports them, and we're lucky to have him. Congratulations, Noah.
Yeah, I'd like to add a few words as other firefighters and your buddies come up here. I've got the Public Safety Appreciation Award, and standing here as Chief Pelfrey was talking and looking at this guy that, you know, looks like a Greek god here with his shoulders, and I think he could probably carry Commissioner Stover and Commissioner Hart out of a burning building, one in each arm. So
probably not Stover.
But yeah, as y'all come on across, the Board of Commissioners accepts this nomination and with great joy want to participate in this award. The award is presented to Noah Braden in recognition of outstanding service to his community, presented by the Paulding County Board of Commissioners this 20th day of September 2018, and all five of your commissioners have signed it there. I just noticed there is one typo on there, so if you just hold it for the picture and then let me get that corrected. Thanks to all of y'all for the work you do.
No. Let Brandon get a picture of me. I'm going to send it to Dana.
Thank you. Makes my day, Jason. Noah, hand that to Tommy so I can, we can get it corrected. Thank you. Okay, you have no invited guests this morning. Under bid awards, item number two is discuss action to award the purchase of replacement computers to the lowest responsible bidder, CDWG, in the amount of $223,622.70. This is Tabitha Pollard, our finance director.
Good morning. Every year we bring a computer bid to you, and it's one that's been listed in the budget. It's a budgeted expense, capital expense. We have them on a rotating schedule. We rotate about every 3 years. What we try to do, we had reduced it back a few years ago when we were reducing expenses, and now we're trying to catch those back up. So last year we did public safety. These are primarily for the courthouse. There's a few additionals that have made, COVID's made a few changes, made us try to be a little more remote in some areas. So we've got some additional outside of the courthouse that have been requested. This year we originally requested one processor, and the bids came back a little high, so we went back with a different processor. We went down to an i5 processor to reduce that bid some, and then we reduced the number of machines. The intent is we'll have to add those machines to a later purchase, but it reduces it, gets it within budget for this year. The original budget was $200,000. This bid is for $223,622.70. Some of that is coming from departments that have made the request for remote access, so they'll be funding a piece of it, and the rest of it will come from IT's budget. They did have a few items that came in under budget, so it keeps their overall budget intact. So unless you have any questions, and CDWG was the lowest bidder.
Had some good backup material on that, and assume no one has any questions. Okay, moving on to number three, discuss action to award a contract to DAF Concrete Incorporated for the annual paving and concrete work contract, providing services including paving, concrete work, and landscaping services over the next 12 months at a unit cost not to exceed $585,650.
So I'll give this a stab, and then Ms. Ashmore may have to add to it if I miss something, because this one is new. This was not something that we've done before in this manner. So when we go out to make water line repairs, sometimes we have to dig up people's yards or maybe get under their driveways. And in doing that, we try to put back as much as we can to the same state as was before we had to dig it up to make the repair. So we have a couple of contractors that have been working for us in the past, and we've coordinated the landscaping, we've coordinated concrete or whatever might have to take place for each one of those. And we have since experimented with the repair, some of the contractors that we've used for the repair, for them to be able to make the landscape repairs as well. That's worked pretty well. So we put the water system put together a packet, and it consolidated a lot of the different items that they would need for landscape and for concrete, and put it into one bid. We put that on the street. We received two bids. There's a pretty big difference between those two. The lowest bid is in line with what we've spent over the past couple of years for this type work, and we hope that it will make it a little more a little easier for our guys to have one person that they call to make sure that the work's being done and the contractors aren't in each other's way. So, Lori, do you have anything to add?
Okay. I just wanted to share, this has been quite a package to get out onto the street and get bids on. Appreciate the work of Department of Transportation reviewing this for the road specs for repaving. Like to think about it this way. It really is an improvement in customer service. If it was in your front yard and you had three contractors coming at various times to repair things versus one comes, he's going to be fully responsible for getting everything fixed. That's what we're going for. To be able to do that at the same or lower cost, unit costs that we have been paying has been a great find, and we're looking forward to this not only reducing costs but improving customer service.
For there to be such a big difference between the bids, I mean, do you think maybe the higher one just misunderstood or didn't? I mean, that's a big difference.
Actually, there was one number on the second bid that appeared to be a typo.
Oh, okay.
That led to it being so out of line. If it was brought down in line, everything else fell almost equal.
Do you know other counties that have gone to this procedure method?
Yes, we have other counties throughout the metro area that have annual price contracts for their restoration after repairs or as part of their overall annual contracts for services.
Other questions? Thank you, Ms. Ashmore. We're pleased today to have a report from our chief appraiser, Mr. James Stokes, who is going to tell us a little bit about the 2021, the fiscal year we're ending here on June 30th. So, James, lay it on us.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen. It has been roughly a year since I've been before y'all. For the last year, as well as everybody else, they've wanted to know what has COVID done to the real estate market in Paulding. The real estate market has exploded. People are realizing that they no longer have to drive into the perimeter to have a good paying job. They work from home now. We're also seeing a lack of available homes, whether new construction or existing homes. They're simply not out there. Interest rates remain to be historic lows. Marketing times are currently less than 15 days. That time should be somewhere around 50 days. All of our appraisers are working as hard as they can to keep up with what's going on in the county. Last year, we just recently completed our digest year. The tax commissioner just turned it over to his vendor. Matter of fact, yesterday we signed off on it. Our staff has made three passes just to make sure we have everything as correct as possible for this year. Saying that, they have processed right at 14,000 transfers in the county. That's transferring about 9,300 properties. And I always receive a question, well, you know, you got 14,000 transfers, but it's only transferring 9,000 properties or however many. Well, you have a lot of properties that you'll have one deed transferring 30 lots. So that's where you have that difference. We've added about 3,200 homes this year. No, excuse me. We've added about 3,200 homestead exemptions this year. We've added about 1,500 new homes this year. I know that's a little bit different than community development's numbers, but there's a lack in a few months. When we add a home, well, you might be permitting it in November, December. Well, we're not actually going, there's no home to even measure on our January 1 assessment date. The staff has gone three times through the numbers on 719 separate developments. It's taken them literally 3 months to make those three turns throughout the entire process. They've been providing reports on their status to our Board of Assessors. Our Board of Assessors approved those digest numbers back in early May. So what does this mean? The average homeowner wants to know, what does this mean to me? On May 28th, we'll be sending our annual notices of assessment out. There's about 70,000 of those notices go out. There'll be a 45-day appeal period. We have dedicated phone lines that we have to answer questions. That 45-day appeal period ends July 12th. We've got all hands on deck for those 45 days. Any questions that we have, any emails that we have, we do our best to answer those concerns on a daily basis. I don't want somebody to go 2, 3, 4 days out without getting some type of response. We're very proactive in everything we do. We have all of our information will be on the website on May 28th. We've got around 7,600 transactions. They are sorted on the paulding.gov website under the assessor section. They're sorted by subdivision and then by sales. And then we also leave all of the previous years on there. So you want to see what's going on in your local market, it's pretty easy to scroll down to your subdivision, just get a ballpark. What are things actually going for? And look back and see what things are. To put this in perspective, at the bottom of the market in 2012, the average home sale price was $98,000. It's $255,000 now. That's a very short time period with that kind of value change. And that's with even this year and the pandemic going on, we've had 1,000 more transactions than we had even in the previous year. Like I said, we will have all of our information on the web. Our QPublic website, it is very active. I ran the numbers yesterday. Since January 1st, that website has had over 240,000 visits. People are looking. It's very easy to go on that website, search up your neighborhood, look in the details on everything, look at their values. You can download your entire neighborhood, put it into an Excel document, do some comparisons, do your research before you get sticker shock and call our office. Take time to review what's happening in your local markets. A better informed person can make a better decision. But of course, I do not want anybody to miss their 45-day appeal period. If you can't sleep at night with what's on that number, then you need to appeal it. I make no bones and never have about that. You can always withdraw your appeal. I just want to make sure that everybody's aware that we are sending these notices. They're going out at the end of the week. Historically, people start getting them in the mailbox about Tuesday lunchtime. And at this time, if anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to answer any of your questions.
So, and it's based on just because the notice that they received doesn't actually mean what the tax bill is going to be exactly, because
that is one thing that we absolutely hate with the notice, is that assessment notice has an estimated tax. They put that into the law several years ago. We receive more phone calls and questions about that than we do the actual value. That if the governing authorities roll back a millage rate, by law, it has to be the most recent approved millage rate. So it's last year's millage rate. Right. So if the governing authorities roll back millage rate, that's not the tax. So that is, when they added that in there, no one from our industry was happy, because it's not representative of what people see later in the year.
And what I wish I would have got you to look this up, but as far as like in 2005 and 6, when the numbers was probably at the highest before the recession, or
we're above that.
Yeah, right. I was just wondering what year do you think that we finally hit those 05, 06 numbers, like 2017, 18, 19, and when did we surpass them? Because it took a while to get back up to that.
Are you talking about just new construction,
value, or
just
wise?
The value-wise? The value-wise, I'm thinking somewhere around 15.
15,
16. And the reason, you know, I mean, you can see it. We're talking to a lot of homeowners right now. They have outstanding permits, primarily in the rural sector, where they've gone and got pre-qualified to build a house out on 5-10 acres of land. They've been approved for construction loans. They've broke ground. You know, their framing package is $45,000 more, and they're having to go back to the bank. I mean, construction cost is out of sight right now. But it's in a lot of sectors, it's not slowing down the buyer. Anything else?
Thanks so much for that update, James.
Thank you very much.
I have no one who signed up for agenda items this morning. Under the consent agenda, there are four items. The item number four is to adopt water system job classification for capital projects inspection specialist. Number five is to adopt resolution 20-11, a resolution of Paulding County, Georgia, to adopt the 2021 amendment to the joint comprehensive plan for Paulding County. And item number six is to adopt the revised job description and reclassification of the senior administrative assistant to the Board of Commissioners chair. And item number seven is Sergeant Ted Carpenter is retiring from the sheriff's office on May the 31st, 2021. The policy to retire a service pistol to a deputy has been met by Sergeant Carpenter, and the sheriff's office requests to retire Sergeant Carpenter's Glock pistol. Would any of the commissioners like to place any of those four items under regular business? Hearing none, we'll leave them as consent agenda items. Item number eight is new business, which is discuss the action to adopt resolution 21-12, imposing a 180-day moratorium on single-family residential build-to-rent land. Let me say it all in one phrase: single-family residential build-to-rent land use activities. And our county attorney, Mr. Jason Phillips, is available to brief us.
Commissioners, this moratorium is in response to what appears to be a national trend for residential construction and development. What we've seen nationally in many areas is situations where developers are taking entire developments, entire subdivisions. They are building single-family dwellings, just like we traditionally have across the nation. They've got an entire subdivision full of houses. But rather than selling them to first-time, or rather than selling them to owners, instead of selling, they're leasing all the homes in the subdivisions to essentially tenants. And this is something that read articles on it, has begun to emerge really in the past couple of years in the metro area. Both the city of Stockbridge and the city of Woodstock have placed moratoria on this type of development to give them an opportunity to see what type of land use challenges, what type of planning challenges are going to arise because of this different model. As you well know, the various zoning districts in Paulding County, they are designed for, many of them, designed for single-family residential structures that are going to be owned by homeowners. They are not designed for the circumstance where, rather than homeowners, you're going to have an entire development full of tenants. So what this moratorium does, it puts a pause on that for 180 days, to allow staff and myself to take a look at it and come up with recommendations as to what we believe would be the best way to plan and the best way to regulate those types of uses moving into the future. So that is what that is, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thanks, sir. We have no old business this morning, no one who signed up for non-agenda items. At this time, we'll ask for comments and announcements from the commissioners. If you have anything you want to advertise or speak to, why don't we start with ladies first and just start with Sandy.
On June the 6th, that's on a Sunday, at Wellstar Paulding Hospital, they're doing a Cancer Survivors Day celebration. They're going to have a parade around the hospital, so they want you to decorate your cars, dress as superheroes, and come down to the hospital on Sunday. Sounds like it's going to be a pretty cool event, so I would love to see you there.
Thank you. We'll move on to post number one. You're good today? He's going to save his for tonight, I'm sure. Brian, what do you have, sir?
Nobody else. Chuck, you didn't have nothing to say?
I'm next. He just skipped me.
Oh.
When he goes last, you always complain.
Just letting it, I got an email the other day. I was actually going to have a private cleanup at High Shows Park today at 1 o'clock. It's a homeschool group that's getting together. If anybody would like to maybe go help, they're actually putting together, to go down there and have a cleanup. So just letting anybody know that might want to show up to help.
I want to thank the board because I go in my mind, I went back to when we talked about nepotism and we passed a policy several months back. That gentleman sitting in front of us was a second generation firefighter, and those are your leaders. Those guys who live it, eat it, and drink it before they actually get old enough to even be in it. And I'm just proud of him. There was another one in the back that's the second generation. Always proud of those guys.
I can't do without them. What to close out, actually, right before I ask for a motion to go into executive session, again, just being 6 days from Memorial Day, and you know, it's different from Veterans Day. Memorial Day is about those that actually didn't come back. So we've got a little video here that you might want to get out of Kleenex. I don't know.
We are a nation under God, and I believe God intended for us to be free. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David. Their lives ended in places called Bellow Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. They add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom.
Oh,
I think I can speak on behalf of the entire board and our full staff. If there are any of those of you that are listening at home or in the room that have lost somebody, our heart goes out to you for that loss. I will entertain a motion to go into executive session for real estate.
Make a motion that we go into executive session for real estate.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Caker. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned into executive session.